I see your grace from the fountain. I felt you there in the valley below. I see your love and your mercy. You guided me home. I know you're in every season. I feel your hand bring your peace and control.
Jesus, your love is my anchor.
On fire.
Hallelujah.
Jesus, our victory. The sound of triumph. The song inside us. Jesus, our victory. We will be silent. Our hearts on fire. Jesus, our victory. The sound of triumph.
Seat there in front of you have these great publication cards here. We have connection cards, prayer cards, and your new Northgate notes. I'm sorry, I forgot to introduce myself. I am Adam Gray. I'm one of the elders here at Northgate Community Church, and I am also the saxophone player. Hi. So the connection cards, this is a way that we can stay in touch with you. We like to know who you are. We welcome you here. We add you to our prayer list. The prayer card is if you should have prayer requests of your own you wish to submit. And the Northgate Notes, which is new as of this month, lists all the fun things coming up. I think Pastor Michael will go over this later on. He is here. Good deal. Please join me as we pray for this morning's service. Father God, we thank you for this corner. Thank you for this building. Thank you for all of these people here. Thank you for this body of believers, Lord. Pray that you would bless our service, bless our worship. May it be a sweet sound into your ears. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Hallelujah. Let's lift him up. Thank you, Jesus.
All the poor and powerless, and all the lost and lonely, all the thieves will come confess and know that you are holy, and know that you are holy. In all we'll sing out hallelujah, and we will cry out hallelujah. Oh, all the hearts who are content, all that feel unworthy, and all who hurt but nothing live, will know that you are holy. In all we'll sing out hallelujah, and we will cry out hallelujah.
My right.
it runs deep. Your grace is more, grace is found. 'Cause where you are, Lord,
oh, I am free.
Holiness is Christ in me. Where you are, Lord,
oh, I am free.
Hallelujah, thank you, Jesus.
Holiness is Christ in me.
Comes my way, and when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay.
When I cannot stand, I'll fall on you.
Jesus, you're my hope and stay.
Chains, I came to your door and fell on the floor of mercy. Guilty I stood, and guilty I was. I couldn't hide my shame. Just as I am, just as I am, Jesus, you welcome me, you took me in. I'll never be the same again. My life is held in your hands, just as I am.
You.
just as I am. Jesus, you welcome me. You took me in. I'll never be the same again. My life is held in your hands. Just as I am. Just as I am. Jesus, you
Jesus, thank you so much that you see us just as we are, that you invite us into your presence. Thanks to the holy righteousness of your Son, Jesus Christ, we are clothed in him, and you see us just as we are. We can have relationship with you thanks to the forgiveness of your Son, Jesus, and the work that he did on the cross to make this new covenant, this new promise with us. A covenant of grace and mercy and truth and love. In the precious and holy name of Jesus, amen. Well, good morning. I am Michael Gilmore, the associate pastor here at Northgate, and I am excited to talk to you. I get a couple minutes this morning to talk to you because this month is, and this morning, we get to celebrate. We're about halfway through our capital campaign of talking about being going forward together. And if you haven't picked up on that, surprise, we're in a capital campaign. It's called Forward Together. We're moving forward together. And we've been praying and we've been talking about stewardship and generosity. And God is doing some awesome things. So it's time to celebrate. It's time to talk about what God is doing. I want to point you first to our Northgate notes. This is we do these every month to let you know some of the biggest things that are happening and stories of what God is doing in our community. And this month, we got a couple of things about the Forward Together campaign that I want to just give you a heads up on. We don't want anyone to be surprised by this. And while I know all of you diligently read each and every one of these words, right? I still want to walk through it with you. So, first of all, we are in our 40 days of prayer and fasting. If you've signed up, thank you so much. Thank you for praying and fasting with us these past 20 days. We are exactly halfway through, I think, if my math is correct. And if you haven't signed up, we want you to still join us. You can still sign up on the calendar out there. Pick a day that hasn't happened yet, because you can't fast a time that you already ate on a day, you know, in the past. So look ahead to the future. Pick a new day in the future and join us. You don't have to give up something for 40 days. We want you to give up just a few meals for one day so that as a body of believers, as a church, we're covering each and every one of these 40 days in prayer and request that God would, that his favor would rest upon us. So please join us in that. Be sure to stop by the calendar. It's right up by the doors before you leave. And then that 40 days concludes with a 24 hours of prayer. And that is happening here at the church, March 22nd to the 23rd from 6 p.m. to 6 p.m. It's a come and go. You don't have to stay the whole time, though you certainly could if you're super, super spiritual. But you can come and go as you like or as the Lord leads you. You know, if you wake up at 2 in the morning and you're just like, I need to pray, that don't let that pass by. Act on that. Sometimes we have stories of other churches who've done this kind of 24 hours prayer, and there's people that just wake up in the middle of the night and God has called them to pray. Come and join us. There'll be people here the whole 24 hours. So March 22nd to 23rd is fantastic. Then March 31st is our Pledge Sunday. This is a capital campaign. Many of you know to get in this building, we had to take on $2.2 million of debt. And the biggest goal of this whole campaign is to get out of that, to be freed from that, to see God's provision in many different ways. And so March 31st is your opportunity to pledge. And we have pledge cards made up, and we'll give those to you ahead of time so you can prayerfully consider how God is calling you to be committed to the vision and mission of Northgate. We don't want you to be surprised. We don't want it to be an emotional or pressured decision, because this is about you and Jesus. This is between you and God. What has God called you to do? We don't have a set thing of, oh, I'll do this much, or this much, because it's up to you and your relationship with Jesus and how God has called you to partner with this body of Christ. So March 31st is that Sunday where you'll turn in your cards and we'll have a big collection. It's going to be a wonderful Sunday. But April 7th is the one that you don't want to miss, because that is going to be our big celebration. This is very special because we're doing one service. And you guys are you don't have to change anything. So we're doing, everyone is coming to the 11 o'clock service, your service. And we're all going to come together as one big body of Christ. It's going to be packed. It's going to be fun. It's going to be exciting. We're going to announce the pledge totals and what God is going to be doing as we move forward together. We're excited because forward together is not just about money. It's about the vision of Northgate. It's about what God has called us to do. It's not just about reducing debt, though that's important, but having funds to impact our community around us, to get our foot in the door in James Workman and minister to junior hires that are just a golf shot away. It's about partnering with people like The Narrow Door and giving them a foothold in the west end of the valley to serve the needs of this community. And forward together is all of that. And so I hope that you prayerfully consider and take this seriously, what God is calling you to do and how you can be involved with the dreams and visions and aspirations that the leadership of this church has. But we need you to partner with us. And so April 7th is a celebration of all of that. And so we'll all be together during the 11 o'clock service. Then afterward, we're having a party outside with food trucks and games and fun. It's just a huge celebration, and I hope that you'll join us. It will be fantastic. And also on April 7th, we have a very special opportunity because we have a generous donor who gave us $25,000 towards a matching gift. So any gifts, oh yes, amen to that. So any gifts that are given on April 7th that are above and beyond your normal giving and your pledge will be matched and doubled. And so we are so excited to see how God is providing and how he will provide through that, and invite you into that. Let's make that happen. Let's see all of that fulfilled. So there's so much going on here at Northgate. I hope you're involved, you're connected. I hope you're on our email lists, and I hope you have our app, and I hope you're on our Facebook and Instagram, because God is doing amazing things. And one of those things, on a side note, but beyond the forward together stuff, is we have prayer. After this service up in the youth room, if you need prayer for healing, if you need prayer for something that's going on in your life, we want to pray for you. And so you can join us up in the youth room after service, where we have our team of prayer warriors willing to sit before the throne of God with you and lift up the things that are going on in life. So please feel free to join us after service up in the youth room for that. But, okay, so this morning is all about celebration, right? This whole month is about celebration. And the last weekend, I got to go up to Crestline, California. Yes, and give a hand. Where we had our winter camp. And I want to show you just some pictures and stuff of what God is doing and how amazing of a weekend it was. We crammed 20 students and 6 leaders into a half a dozen cars, I think, and went up the mountain. And even getting there that Friday was just of the Lord, because all of Thursday night and Friday morning, the roads were closed. You were not allowed to go up the mountain because of snow and ice. You needed to have chains on your cars or be a 4x4. It was a little windy going up, but they took pictures nonetheless. I didn't take those pictures, but I was driving. Don't worry about that. But by Friday afternoon at 4 o'clock, when we left, the roads were clear, and everyone was able to go up and get there safely. And so praise the Lord, even just getting us there. Polaris was the theme of the weekend, and the focus verse was 2 Timothy chapter 3, 16 and 17. All scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. If you're astrologically inclined, you know that Polaris is the North Star. It's the star that, for thousands of years, has given people who are lost, who are trapped in storms, it's given them direction. It's given them a way home. We learned that this word of God is our Polaris. It's our true north. It's the way we go. It's where we look to for guidance and truth. And our students discovered that this book is full of truth, and this book is reliable, and this book can guide them to solid ground. And so amongst all of that learning and growth and discovery and worship, we had a lot of fun. We made snowmen. This is the micro snowman that Sadie and I built. He kind of survived the weekend. He was half ice, and there's oatmeal over there. Don't worry about him. But to have students take students up here, to some of them experience snow for the very first time, and they come to me and say, "Pastor Michael, why are my hands burning?" And I say, "Because you're stupid." No, I don't. I didn't say that. But this is a celebration morning, and we're celebrating that I get to do this because of you. Because of your commitment to this church, because of your willingness to give generously and honestly, students like this get to hear the word of God every Wednesday, and they get to go up to camp and have these lifelong memories made because of you. So thank you. Thank you for partnering, for trusting Northgate with your commitment. There's so many fun things that our students get to do, and I know I'm not delusional. They're not going to remember 99% of what I say, but they're going to remember when they played paintball for 4 hours straight because they could. I don't know why their feet became numb, but they did it, and they're going to remember that. They're going to remember building snow walls. They're going to remember this, and we can do that because of you. So thank you. February, we brought in over $63,000 of funds. I've been here for 6 years, and I've never seen a $63,000 month. So thank you. God is doing something amazing because you are responding to his call in your heart and your life to commit to him, to give to him, to move forward together for the purposes of God in your life and in this church. Winter camp is always a crazy weekend, but it's always so much fun. And I'm always reminded of how amazing our students are and how much more they seem to pick up than I even give them credit for. To watch half a dozen junior high boys respond to an altar call, that's not always possible for them to follow any kind of instruction. But they did all the right things, and they responded. They took that handful of sand, and they dumped it on the cross. They picked up a rock to remind themselves that Jesus is their foundation, that the word of God is their truth. So thank you. Thank you for letting us go, for allowing me to do this job, to serve you in so many different ways. And it's only through your commitment to this church. These next 5 years, as we go forward together, God is going to do some awesome things. And we're already, as I mentioned, laying the groundwork to get in and restart the Christian Club at James Workman, to partner with Coachella Valley Rescue Mission and Narrow Door and so many other things. We want to move forward together, but we need everyone on board. Just like when they crossed the Jordan, the Israelite army had to be all in, all together. And that's what we're calling you to do, to go forward together with us. You've got like two more sermons this morning, so I want to invite the ushers forward this morning as I just, we're going to do take our, receive the tithes and offerings, and I want to pray a blessing upon it as we just continue to give praise back to God. Father God, we worship you now by giving back to you. giving back to the things that you're doing here on earth and through Northgate. Through the people here, Lord, you are changing lives. You're transforming lives. You're bringing impact that is beyond understanding because it's of you. Father God, we give back to you just a portion of what you've blessed us with. You've given us so much, your love, your grace, your mercy. You've given us food and home and shelter and cars and all these things, and we just give it back to you because it's all yours to begin with. And we give back generously, and we give back in faith that you are our provider, not ourselves, not our job, not our friends, not our family. You provide everything that we need. So we trust and believe in you and your call in our hearts and our lives, and we give generously back to you. May you receive this offering, Lord, these tithes, and may they be a pleasant aroma. May you have regard for them, Lord, and multiply them to be used in a mighty way for your kingdom here on earth. In the precious and holy name of Jesus Christ, amen.
Hi, we're Mark and Janelle Farrison, and it's been our privilege to serve and grow at Northgate Community Church for the last 15 years. It's especially been a privilege to worship with you and to help lead in worship on Sunday mornings. And Janelle has a story of God's provision to share with you today.
So I struggled with upper respiratory issues for like my whole life. And but I've always enjoyed singing, and the Lord has brought worship to my heart. And about 10 years ago, I was having lots of issues and had trouble, would lose my voice a lot, and was unable to be part of the worship team anymore, had to step down. I went to the doctor, went to a specialist, and he basically said that I had nodules on my vocal cords. And when I asked him what I would do to fix it, he said, there's nothing you can do, but just don't talk and rest your voice. So that was, so I felt pretty defeated, and I felt like things were very dark, and it took me a while before I was able to kind of process through. Basically, I just came to the point where I recognized God's sovereignty over my life, and I knew that it was something that the Lord had given me, a love for singing, and I needed to just let go of it because it wasn't mine, it was His. And that if He wanted to bring that in my life again, He would. But I truly, truly just had to be able to just let go and be willing to say that I may never sing again. I was totally at peace with where the Lord had brought me. I counted on Him to provide. He began the work of worship and singing again in my life. It's not perfect, and it definitely, I still have issues at times, but it keeps me very dependent on Him, and it keeps me trusting Him literally on a daily basis, or at least a weekly basis. And I have to say too that sometimes throughout the week, I think to myself, how am I going to get up there and sing on Sunday? I can barely. And then I get up there, and God makes it happen. I'm very thankful for His provision, and I love the Lord very much, and I know He loves me.
So. 2019 is going to have some challenges for us as a Northgate family, and our prayer is that we'll all be able to pull together, and that as a group, we'll be able to trust in the Lord and His provision, to realize that everything we have is truly from Him, and to give it back to Him, and then to trust Him to do the rest.
The end.
Yay! Great job, Dad, great job.
Amen. We love stories of God at work. And just like that, if you have stories giving God glory, please tell Pastor Michael. He can make everyone look good on video. He really can. Yeah, that's true. Y'all don't look that great. No. Let me side mark of that. After both the first service and this service, we have a team of people up in the youth room that would love to pray for you. If you're struggling with a health issue or of any certain prayer requests that you have, if you take the elevator upstairs and go straight out the elevator down a short hallway, there is a team of people that are there praying with people from the first service. But after this service, they will be there to pray with you as well. And it's really astounding what God has done. I had one of the individuals tell me just last night, or maybe it was the day before, that they had on Monday been in the emergency room for a 5 millimeter, that sounds so huge, kidney stone. They were just doubled over. And they took x-rays and everything, and they had there, and there's five other ones that were ready to go. And the individual remembered that and started praying, and the doctors came in to admit them into the hospital to deal with this. And they're like, on a scale of 1 to 10, what's your pain? He goes, like, I got no pain. And they're like, no, you have to have pain. Anyway, he checked himself out and has no issues. You know, God is in the business of healing. And so your act of faith is to go and let them pray over you. We're going to celebrate the Lord's table this morning. If you have your Bibles, go to Exodus chapter 12. While you're turning to Exodus chapter 12, please don't raise your hand. I'm going to ask you a question. Because Jesus, he would go to church, and he would heal on church day. I'm using modern day terms. And it would really irritate the religious righteous. It's like, you're not supposed to work. Why are you working? Stop that. This is church. Don't you know things like that aren't supposed to happen here? Right? Well, I have this distraction because I have my father, bless his heart. He passed away and went to be with Jesus in 1997. But I tell you what, he would have beat the crap out of me if I wore a hat in church. And so I'm sitting, he would have. So I'm sitting there in this religious righteousness. Now, this is a question. Were you distracted because of a hat in church? Don't answer out loud, because it's not a good answer if it were. You see, it doesn't matter to Jesus. He doesn't care about the hat. He cares about a heart. And it's important. You know, I'm sitting there, my conflict comes because of a rule that my father established. You show respect by God by not wearing a hat in church. Yes, sir. Get the crap beat out of me if I don't. And he loved me, and so he beat the crap out because he loved me. Discipline is always about love. That doesn't make any sense, I know. But that's why Hebrews 12 says, all discipline seems painful. I think there's certain extremes you don't do. I got to just back out of this one here. This isn't about discipline. This is about the distraction of somebody not following your rules. You're in the house of God. Jesus loves us the way we are, and that's why we're coming to Exodus chapter 12. As we prepare for the Lord's table, I find it fascinating that we often do things out of rules, habits. We often do things because, well, that's what you do at church. And so this is sermon number one. Michael said two sermons. I got another one after this one too, but we're just going to very quickly look at the 12th chapter of Exodus. We're going to pick it up in verse 21 because Moses called for the elders. They're the 12 plagues of Israel, the 10 plagues of Israel, 9 of them had happened. The 10th one, which is the firstborn of every household, was about to happen, but Moses needed to warn. So he called the elders of the Israel to them and said, go select lambs for yourselves according to the clans. Kill the Passover lamb. Take a bunch of hyssop, dip it in the blood that is in the basin. Touch the lintel and the two doorposts with the blood that is in the basin. None of you shall go out of the door of his house until morning. For the Lord will pass through to strike the Egyptians, and when he sees the blood on the lintel and on the two doorposts, the Lord will pass over the door and will not allow the destroyer to enter your houses to strike you. You shall observe this as a rite and a statute for you and your sons forever. And then you come to the land the Lord gives you. He has promised you shall keep this service. And when your children say to you, why do you mean by this service? What do you mean by this service? You shall say, it is the sacrifice of the Lord's Passover, for he passed over the houses of the people of Israel in Egypt when he struck the Egyptians, but spared our houses. And the people bowed their heads and worshipped. When the people of Israel went and did so, the Lord had commanded Moses that they did. There's this incredible thing, then, that the death angel passed through, and those who did not have the blood of the sacrificial lamb on the doorposts of the house, firstborn would die, the eldest child. Didn't matter if they were royalty or slave, there was death. We come to the Gospel of Mark. So, Mark chapter 14. Jesus has said the time is fulfilled. He's about ready to be crucified, and the uniqueness of the crucifixion is that it happened on the Passover weekend. Do you connect? The Passover lamb that was celebrated hundreds of years earlier and throughout that every year. Now Jesus, the sacrificial lamb for us, is fixing to die, and his blood is being shed for us. Do this in remembrance of me. And so in the 14th chapter of the Gospel of Mark, on the 12th verse, in the first day of the unleavened bread, when they sacrificed the Passover lamb. See, they're still doing it hundreds of years later. His disciples said to him, where will you have us go to prepare for you to eat the Passover? And he sent two of his disciples ahead. Jump to verse 22, and they were eating in the upper room. He took bread, and after blessing it, he broke it and gave it to them. Take this. This is my body, verse 23. And he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, and they all drank it. And he said to them, this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. Truly I say to you, I will not drink again of the fruit of the vine until the day when I drink it anew in the kingdom. This happens in the Passover because Jesus is the sacrificial lamb. His blood over the door, our life, is all that the Father looks for to protect you from the judgment that is to come. Grasp that. It's not about what you have done or haven't done. It's not about how much money or who you know. It's about, do you embrace Jesus and allow the blood of Jesus to cleanse you from all unrighteousness? You are covered in the righteousness of Christ. There's a beautiful picture in Revelation chapter 5 of the sacrificial lamb. So in Revelation 5 and verse 1, it says, then I saw on the right hand, this is John who was taken up into the heavenly and shown of the things to come, as we see Revelation with the very title of the Bible book. But in the fifth chapter, John sees at the right hand of him, sees God sitting on his throne, and there's a scroll, and it's written on the back and sealed with seven seals, and I saw a mighty angel proclaiming with a loud voice, who is worthy to open the scroll and break its seals? And no one in heaven or on earth or under the earth was able to open the scroll or to look into it. And I began to weep loudly because no one was found worthy to open the scroll or look into it. And one of the elders said to me, weep no more. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has conquered so that he can open the scroll and its seven seals. Verse 6. Between the throne and the four living creatures and among the elders, I saw a lamb standing as though it had been slain, with seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent out into all the earth. And he went and took the scroll from the right hand of him who was seated on the throne. And when he had taken the scroll, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the lamb, each holding a harp and a golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. Did you know that your prayers don't just die? They don't just fall to the floor. They are collected as an incense, a fragrance. They're eternal. They're an eternal sweet fragrance unto the Father. In verse 9, and he sang a new song. They sang, everyone there in heaven, worthy are you to take the scroll and to open its seals, for you were slain, and your blood you ransomed people for God. From every tribe, language, nation, and people, and you have made them a kingdom, priests who are God, and they shall reign on the earth. Then I looked, and I heard around the throne of the living creatures and the elders the voices of many angels, numbering myriads of myriads and thousands of thousands, saying with a loud voice, worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power, wealth, wisdom, might, honor, glory, and blessing. And I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and in the sea and all that is in them saying, to him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be blessing and honor and glory and might forever and ever. And the four living creatures said amen, and the elders fell down and worshiped. We come to the communion table to remember what he did. It's not about you. It's all about him. I'm going to ask if five elders would come forward, if Pastor Houston and Pastor Michael would come. This is the Lord's table. It's not Northgate's table. If you know Jesus as your Savior, this is time for you to remember. Do this in remembrance of me. I'm going to have the elders pass out the bread, and then when you just hang on to it, when you come back, Pastor Michael will lead in a time of prayer and thanksgiving. The elders will pass out the cup, hang on to it. Pastor Houston will lead a prayer of thanksgiving. They'll partake together.
You know, it's good that this time can be quiet and somber and give us a moment to reflect, to confess, to make our relationship with Jesus right. I often think of communion as an opportunity to reset, to restart. But this is also a moment of celebration, because this represents not just the death of Jesus, which is tragic, but the fulfillment of the Old Testament, of this old covenant, and a covenant is just this super promise that God made with the people of Israel, and Jesus did it. He fulfilled it so that we can have a new promise, a new covenant, a new relationship with God without all the strings attached, right? It's a celebration. That's part of what we're remembering, not just his sacrifice and the love that he had for us to take the beatings, the mocking, the pain, the suffering, but we're celebrating. God did this. He did it, right? Father God, thank you for doing it, for being the sacrifice, for being the the perfect sacrifice, the sacrifice to end all sacrifices. You have taken our place. Your word tells us, for the wages of sin is death. But the free gift of God is eternal life in you. That is what we remember. Thank you, Lord. We praise you. We celebrate you this morning for your love, your mercy, your grace, your truth that you poured out through your Son, Jesus. We come before you now humbly and remember your sacrifice. Amen. Let's partake together.
Do you know what an aha moment is? Let me explain it this way. Have you ever been with a group of people and someone told a joke and everybody's laughing and you didn't get the joke? And you kind of, that's good. But like 2 days later, I got it. As a teacher, it's great when you see that aha moment in the face of the class where two pieces get connected that were totally separate in their minds, but all of a sudden a bridge, a link was connected. Can you imagine what was going on in the upper room that night when Jesus said, "This is my body, it's been broken for you. This is my blood, it'll be poured out for the forgiveness of your sins." I mean, Peter wasn't sitting there going, "That's deep." They were staring at each other. They had no idea what this guy was talking about. Until hours later, when they looked up on the cross and they saw their friend lying up there and his body had been beaten and broken. The blood was freely being poured out of his body. And all of a sudden, those words from the night before came flooding back. "This is my body that will be broken for you. This is my blood that will be poured out for the forgiveness of your sins. Do this in remembrance of me." And it didn't make sense then. But isn't that like our God? He's always telling us stuff that makes no sense to us at the time. But then he goes ahead and proves himself to be true. We do this in remembrance of the gift of Jesus Christ, the forgiveness of our sins, the atonement of our sins, and the restoration of a relationship with God. In the name of Jesus. Our Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning and we praise you, we thank you. We approach this time, as Pastor Michael said, it's a time of contemplation, a time of sorrow when we reflect on what it cost. But Father, oh, the joy of knowing that you, from heaven, reached down and loved us so much that you were willing to send your only Son to die on a cross to restore a relationship with us that we might spend eternity with you in heaven. Father, we do this in remembrance of that act, in remembrance of your love, in remembrance of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
The aisle, there's someone who will collect it there. In the 14th chapter of the Gospel of Matthew, I just want to make a single comment, as this is the time when Jesus knows that his hour has come. He leaves the Passover meal and he goes to the Garden of Gethsemane to pray. So we find in verse 32 that they went to a place called Gethsemane. He said to the disciples, "Sit here while I pray." And he took with him Peter, James, and John and began to be greatly distressed and troubled. And he said to them, "My soul is very sorrowful, even to the death. Remain here and watch." And going a little further, he fell on the ground and prayed, as if it were possible that the hour might pass from him. And he said, "Abba, Father, all things are possible for you. Remove this cup from me, yet not what I will, but what you will." And he came and found them sleeping. And he said to Peter, "Simon, are you asleep? Could you not watch 1 hour? Watch and pray that you may not enter into temptation. For the spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak." The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. It's a one-point sermon, so listen carefully. You know that prayer is a foundational piece in your relationship with the Father, but that you and your fleshliness are weak. I am weak. And Jesus says, pray so that you don't enter into temptation. And he comes back, and his assumption is I told you to pray so you don't enter into temptation. But they're asleep. 3 times he does this. They're sleeping. My question is, by sleep, I'm not literally saying that you fall asleep, although that does happen. But I find this to be true, that we drift from prayer. It's like we have this really, there's something in our life that is troublesome and painful, and so we pray and we seek God, and then God intervenes, he interacts, he supplies, and we tend to kind of drift or fall asleep until the next thing happens and it wakes us up and we realize we need to pray. This is my point. He knows our weakness. My question, do you think the Holy Spirit struggles to pray? Does the Holy Spirit struggle to talk to the Father? You see, if you answer that correctly, the answer to that is no. The Holy Spirit delights in bringing glory, delights in having conversation to the Father and to Jesus. And so when you and I struggle in prayer, we are not struggling with prayer, we're struggling with surrendering to the wholeness of the Holy Spirit. I want you to just think about that. Too many times we give all of our effort in prayer based on our own fleshly strength and discipline, and we wonder why it doesn't go anywhere. True prayer is empowered by the Spirit of God. I want you to close your eyes, I want you to bow your head, and I want you to consider this. Do you struggle with prayer? For me, I know there are seasons where I just pray constantly, and there are other seasons where I totally forget. And I realize that although the Spirit is willing, my flesh is weak. If that's true for you, then agree with me in this prayer for yourself. It starts with confession. Lord, I confess that I am weak. I fall asleep, I drift, I forget. But it's not about rules, it's about surrender. So by the power of the Holy Spirit, I surrender all of myself to you, that the Holy Spirit may well up within us, breathing proper prayers of thanksgiving, of supplication, of intercession and confession. We give ourselves to you and ask that you empower us to stay awake and to pray, knowing that as we pray, you receive glory and honor. In Jesus' sweet and precious name, amen. Let's stand. May the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords be profound to you. May you always remember that it's his blood over the doorposts of your heart that redeems you. And the destroyer, the death angel, passes over, because the new covenant in his blood, in his body, he has purchased and covered you. Amen? Amen. Go and have an awesome week, but don't forget, listen, don't forget this. You spring forward next week, so if you show up at 12 when I'm headed home, I know you didn't turn your clock ahead. So, spring forward.